Thank you for being here. My name is Russell Shorto. I'm the director of the John Adams Institute, which is an independent American culture center based here in Amsterdam. What the John Adams normally does is bring American speakers to the Netherlands. In this case, we didn't have to bring anyone because Tracy Metz was already here. She's an American originally. She's been here 30-odd years, I think, as a distinguished journalist for the NRC, an expert on water issues and on the built environment. And in addition, she's happens to be a friend, and in addition to that, she, 5-odd years ago, suggested me for the position of director of the John Adams. So I'm very happy to be able to return the favor in a small way and have her here for this event. When we planned this, Hurricane Sandy had not happened. So when it did, you know, I wouldn't call it an upside, but an upside is that it you know, heightened the focus of an event like this, which is all about Dutch perspectives on water issues, and in particular how, since this is an American culture center, how they can be brought to bear on in an American context. So it makes it all the more interesting what she has to say to us, and I think to the powers that be in the U.S. So we're looking forward to it. Our moderator tonight is Jochem de Vries. He is a lecturer at the Department of Geography, Planning, and International Development Studies at the University of Amsterdam. His research interests are in strategic planning for metropolitan regions, cross-border cooperation and negotiations, the nexus between water management and spatial planning, and methods and skills for planning practice. That's serious stuff. So I think we are in very good hands. Please welcome our moderator, Jochem de Vries.
Thank you, Russell. Yes, and I'm working around the corner here. You are welcome here at CREA, which is the platform of the university to make the connection between the academia and society. I think this is a very appropriate place to have this meeting. As been said, one of my fields of interest is the nexus between planning and water management. And in the Netherlands, these were before, certainly, separate worlds, nearly literally. The areas where water management authorities were responsible, they had the exclusive rights and authority over. Think of dikes, think of the dunes, those types of areas. In the rest of the country, it was the spatial planning regime that was having the authority. And once society decided that a certain area should be developed for housing or would be dedicated to agriculture, then the water managers simply made sure that this activity could take place by preventing it from flooding, by keeping the groundwater table at a certain level. But it's also more metaphorically different worlds. These are very different practices. It is, water management world is dominated by engineers, while when we are talking about urban and regional planning, social scientists are much more involved and important. Decision-making in water management is dominated by experts, while planning has a longer tradition of public participation to reach conclusions. Water management is about clear goals, keeping our feet dry, having clean water. Spatial planning is much more about balancing interests. And as we will see tonight, there are many reasons why these different worlds are colliding more and more. There are changes in society and in the environment that make it necessary that these different types of activities work together more closely. So this is a fascinating subject. And it is with great pleasure and interest that I accepted the invitation of the John Adams Institute to be present tonight to talk about Tracy Metz's book, Tracy Metz and Maartje van der Heuvel's book, Sweet&Salt, Water and the Dutch. And even more so, of course, after I read the book this weekend. What a daunting task. A big subject, water, the source of life. And then in a country where the children's first diploma is a swimming diploma, and the second diploma is also a swimming diploma. It's fundamental. And still, you did a great job. The authors did a great job managing such a big subject. And the angle that you found by discussing water on the basis of the challenges that our society faces, salinization, risks from flooding, preparing cities for climate change, has been a very good one in my view. It avoids holism, but it remains, and it makes very clear why it is such a relevant subject. And at the same time, it's very informative. Of course, we're talking about a journalist. But it also has great depth. It reads like the report of an anthropologist in the field, someone observing a strange culture from the outside, or a travel report exploring uncharted waters. It has a sense of surprise about the ordinary that, if you look a second time, is not so normal at all. Why don't we have evacuation plans? But you will come back to that, I guess. And to be honest, you play the outsider as an American, as a journalist. But of course, you've been a member, as has been said, of the Delta Commission. So you have become an insider as well, a little bit at least. And I learned a lot about the book, amongst other things. Da Vinci was also a water manager. The Dutch variant of waterboarding is putting politicians and administrators in a flood room. This is a cabin where the water level is raised and then they have to keep calm, if I understood right. Aldous Huxley already, the author of A Brave New World, described the Netherlands as a rationalist paradise. But I doubt whether this is a compliment from his mouth. And you show that we are very good in the Netherlands of producing plans, enormous amounts of plans. But I would like to discuss also what comes from all these plans later on. You already toured the world. Now you can have the floor here in Amsterdam.
Thank you so much for joining us here. Nothing is more wonderful for an author to have the opportunity to tell people about what she's done and all the things that she's discovered and how exciting it all was and how beautiful the result is, which you can see for yourself at the table outside the door later. Sweet&Salt is, as Jochem so rightly mentioned, a two-girl project by myself and my colleague Maartje van den Heuvel. She's an art historian specializing in photography. She's a curator at the Special Collections Department of the University Library in Leiden. And she selected the artworks for the exhibition that was held in the Kunsthal in Rotterdam between February 14th, after Prince Willem-Alexander opened the show and accepted the first copy of the book, and June 10th. But because we're speaking this evening specifically about what the U.S. in the wake of Katrina and Sandy can learn from the Netherlands, I'm doing the presentation this evening. Katrina, Sandy, Gustav, Rita, did I mention Irene? How many have we had in very recent future? It made a huge impression on the world, but also on the Netherlands, when in 2005, if I'm not mistaken, there were several hurricanes, actually, but the really big one was, of course, Katrina. And it made a huge impression on the world how vulnerable New Orleans was, how completely unprepared. And of course, the question was, How was that possible? How could they, in a part of the country which is so prone to hurricanes, not have been better prepared? There were heart-rending images that went all over the world, such as this one family, one of hundreds, perhaps even thousands, stranded on the roofs. And I think what was also seen as a scandal in the sphere of governance was how New Orleans was left to its fate after the storm. Of course, it's easy in the U.S. to think, oh, it's just New Orleans. There are a lot of illiterate, poor black people down there. They don't vote. The government is corrupt, so why should the rest of the country spend a lot of money? Why should Arizona be interested in what happens in New Orleans? And this touches on a big issue, which I'll touch on later in my talk as well. For the Netherlands, water safety is a national issue. It's essential to the existence and the survival of the country. In the US, water safety for many is a regional issue. And I think this also comes back to a big difference in mentality, perhaps also in between the US and the Netherlands. In the US, we're much more geared to repair after the fact. We'll do our best and we'll wait and see, and if disaster hits, then we'll fix it. The Netherlands, of course, also given the fact that we are so dependent on our water safety for our very existence, is much more geared to prevention, and I'll be talking about that later. This, of course, is an image that I think many of us will remember, the terrible situation in the Superdome, and I thought this picture was particularly heartrending because you see these people fighting their way through the water to the Superdome in the hope that this will be their salvation. And of course, now we know that this was not their salvation. This was just another variation on hell. Times Square, Sandy, we're moving to New York. Who would have thought that this could happen? Who would have thought that the economic and cultural powerhouse of the US could be brought to its knees this way in such a short time, even with warning? I think this is a situation that perhaps some of us could even imagine happening in the Netherlands. You come out your door, the flood is hit, and what do you do next? Nobody knows. This is the Rockaways, one of the hardest hit parts of the New York area, and it looks like something, it looks apocalyptic. It's really hard to imagine that this really has indeed happened, and you can see the despair in the face of this man on the picture. Sandy, of course, was big. This is not Sandy. I was hoping you would think it was. This is not Sandy. This is an image from the silly science fiction movie, The Day After Tomorrow. And it was a very popular movie because, of course, the combination Manhattan and disaster appeals to everyone's imagination. This, of course, is another silly image from the movie, which actually was very popular, even though it was rather silly. But let me tell you, this is not the movie. This was Sandy. This is real. This really did happen. So perhaps we're moving towards the unthinkable becoming thinkable. This is not Sandy. This is not New York. This is the Netherlands. This is flooding in the southern province of Limburg in the mid-90s, which was the most recent major flood in the Netherlands. We didn't have anything like the damage and the loss of life that would happen with Katrina or Sandy, but it was a major, major event and has started a new kind of thinking in the Netherlands about water safety, which is what I'll be telling you more about tonight. This is another major flood event within the memories of many here in the Netherlands. This was the 1953 flood in the south of the country, in the Delta. And you see, I think, just the magnitude of this. 1,800 people lost their life in one night. 450,000 people lost their homes. Over a million animals drowned. It was so shortly after the war, it was a huge economic disaster and also a really hit hard with the people who already felt quite down and vulnerable. But the 1953 flood, of course, is deeply rooted in popular memory and has also found its way into many children's books, many of which had a charming didactic turn to them and were about various heroic feats. One of the children's books that that I saw had a cover with a girl on a raft with her little dog and wearing clogs, and she was out to save her parents. Another one of them was about a boy who rescued his mother from the roof, which I'm sure all of these things did happen. But you can see that this national disaster is then turned into national folklore and a sort of moralistic beacon for how we can be strong and save each other. Just a little bit of backpedaling for those of you who are not that familiar with the water situation in the Netherlands. As you can see, the blue area is the area below sea level. That means that about 40% of the country is below sea level. And of course, since that's the West, where most of our economy is concentrated, it's interesting to realize that our airport is 4.5 meters below sea level, one of our economic hubs. 60 to 70% of our brutto national product is earned below sea level. Over half our population, so that means over 8 million people, live below sea level. And that's why we're so good at dealing with water. We simply have to in the Netherlands. And that's why after Sandy and Katrina and all the others, and not only from the US, but from all over the world, experts and engineers and hydrologists and politicians flock to the Netherlands after a flood to try to learn from the innovations that we've thought up here. And that water has literally created our landscape, but also created the beauty and the, I think, the feeling and the relationship that Dutch people have to their landscape. These are pictures that I took myself when, as a member of the Delta Commission, we took a trip in a small plane over the Netherlands to really see the water and where it is. And that's, given that the country is so flat, that's really the only way you can see it. And there were some amazingly beautiful images on that trip, seeing how really only then did it penetrate to my brain how determining that element of water is for the landscape and the place we live and the kind of life we live here. The strict geometry of that landscape, it's all determined by drainage ditches and very utilitarian things. But one of the things I love so much about this country is the way the utilitarian has grown its own aesthetic. So how have we gone about making this a safe place to live? Of course, obviously. One of the first things that the Dutch started doing, they first moved onto the higher riverbanks, and then very soon after that, and we're talking about 2 millennia ago, started building dikes. And I love showing this picture in the US because, of course, a lot of people just had the image of a dike, Hans Brinker with his finger in the dike, which makes Dutch people laugh. Although given how sheer and how tight this dike is, maybe this would be a good dike for Hans Brinker after all. But the idea that you are just cycling down the road on a Sunday afternoon and you're at the level of people's attics, I think really makes it clear to a non-Dutch public how essential the dikes are at making the landscape what it is. And this one of the major dikes that has been raised in the 90s near the river area, you see that, I mean, a dike really basically is just a dead thing of earth packed down and piled on with grass on it. But you see that actually in the landscape, they're alive. They shape the landscape and they determine our views and they give us some relief, some height difference in the landscape, which is also a welcome variation here in this very flat country. So after the flood of 1953, the first response was never again. And the Delta Works were initiated, a series of, depending on how you count, 11 to 15 bridges, dams, sluices, storm surge barriers, a huge, huge approach to making the country safe by shortening the coastline by infrastructure. And this was, of course, a much more high-tech, heavy-duty infrastructure than a simple thing such as a dike. Water infrastructure. We have become so incredibly good at this, it's almost scary. This is a set of sluices in Brabant, and I love this picture too because this is the separation between Sweet&Salt. And I think this shows us how reliant we have become and how well-versed we have become at the technology of separating the kinds of water, at all the engineering of the landscape of and of the water through high-tech infrastructure. This is an absolutely magnificent piece of Dutch engineering. When a ship comes in from the salt side, it goes into the lock and the lock door is shut, and then the salt water is heavier than fresh water. So the salt water at the bottom is sucked away into basins, and the sweet water comes from the top. And when the ship is completely in a lock filled with sweet water, with fresh water, then it can pursue its way into the freshwater lake, the idea being that you don't want to have the freshwater lake becoming too saline. And the Dutch have this wonderful word for this process in the lake called embracing sweet. And this was one of the many wonderful terms that I learned in the Dutch water technology, which, just like the landscape, has its own surprising poetry emanating from the utilitarian. This is another, of course, magnificent piece of Dutch infrastructure for dealing with water. And I think now you can see that we're moving towards a new mentality in dealing with water. This is the Maaslandkering, the storm surge barrier that keeps Rotterdam safe from the sea. When the sea rises too high, and we are seaside here, then these two arms swing shut. Both these arms are as high and twice as heavy as the Eiffel Tower. We're talking big. You can go there, you can visit it. It's absolutely stupendous. So when the water threatens to come too high and flood Rotterdam, these gates swing shut and then fill with water and sink to the bottom of the river and then shut the river off for the duration of the high tide or the storm or whatever it is. This doesn't happen very often because this also cuts off shipping to the Rotterdam harbor, which the harbor does not like. But once a year they do a trial with this storm surge barrier to see if the gates still move. And hundreds of people come and they sit on the dikes and the mounds near the barrier just to watch this happen. And then when it actually happens, when they close, they applaud. This is Dutch theater, landscape theater. And this is another absolutely unique and wonderful invention for keeping the water out. In a moment, I'll be talking about letting the water in. But this is one of the really interesting things that the Dutch have devised for keeping the water out. It's an inflatable storm surge barrier. And it's near the town of Kampen, and it's only inflated when there's a high wind and the water from the IJsselmeer threatens to flood the province of Overijssel. And it's only been used a few times, but it lies there quietly on the riverbed. And then when the water threatens to get too high, they pump it full of air and water. And then it can, it's up to 4 meters high. It's like a monster of Loch Ness that rises up to the surface of the water to keep the flooding out. And then when the flood risk is passed, it just deflates and lies back down like a slimy black dragon on the bottom of the river. And I think this is really even more flexible than something like the Maaslandt barrier, because what you don't want is the old-fashioned dams and sluices that have cut off the water from the tides and from the exchange of sweet and salt and have really damaged a lot of the Dutch ecology. So you see that even in that big infrastructure, we're moving now towards structures that are more flexible, more ecologically sensitive. But there's more. And there's more because conditions are changing. The Netherlands are feeling the results and the influence of climate change. We see that, for example, the summers are getting hotter. In 2003, this peat dike suddenly in the middle of the night gave way and moved into a residential area completely unexpectedly. They knew that the dikes could dry out, but they didn't know it was this bad. And a piece about 20 meters long of this dike just in the middle of the night moved into this residential area. I heard that only one inhabitant had seen it happen. Apparently someone who couldn't sleep or was up late, standing on the balcony rolling a cigarette. Can you imagine what a sensation that must have been in the middle of the night to see the dike moving towards you? And this was a result in a very hot summer of the dikes drying out. This, however, is an image from the winter. This is last winter, and this is the river the Waal, which is the most important shipping artery in the Netherlands, a very important economic artery for the economy. And it's so dry that you can see the ships are simply stranded on the bottom of the river. There is no shipping going on at all. So you see that we're getting more extreme weather, drought, and too much rain, too many storms. This, for example, is the center of Rotterdam in the summer. And it's not supposed to be wet in the summer, it's supposed to be dry. But here it is, flooded to almost to the max. This is an interesting example of how Rotterdam is designing for more flexible water conditions. For example, I do have a pointer. You can see that, well, you can't see, but you will when I point it out to you. This is just the sidewalk area, and down here, along these benches, is another red paved sidewalk, which you can use when the water is lower. And the idea of this design is that you can use the street and the sidewalk both in very wet and in drier conditions. So this is another example of flexible design to accommodate more and sometimes less water. Now I want to run through just a few examples of solutions that the innovative and clever Dutch designers and engineers have devised to accommodate water. And with each example, I'll tell you what it's an example of, because as you know, there are so many different conditions that are being brought about by climate change. And there are very many, as Jochem so rightly said, so many different conditions that we have to accommodate now. One of the things that we're confronted with when there's too much rain is that the rain comes pouring down, it crashes into the sewers, and comes right back up again because the sewers just can't accommodate so much water all at once. And this is a design of a parking garage in Rotterdam that has been designed with a basin underneath to absorb that water and hold on to it temporarily and then gradually let it back into the sewer so as to avoid flooding of the streets. Another design for Rotterdam is water squares, where also in dry conditions, like on the top left, they're just normal public squares. When it rains, they can accommodate the water and let it gradually sink back either into the water table, into the ground table, or into the sewer, depending on the local situation. This was also a design for water retention out in the east of the country near Almelo. And I think it's just a lovely idea, as well as a fact, but also the idea that you can make something to store water, also just to store it and to keep it from flooding cities downstream. And that it can be a design which has all the metaphors of water. Of course, meanders, we all associate with rivers, and you do see the river and the water running through it. At the same time, it's so clear that this is a man-made design, and that this is a human artifact for dealing with water. To me, in many ways, this water retention area is almost a metaphor of the whole new approach to water, where man-made design and the forces of nature are trying to be combined to each other's benefit. I asked the designer of this, who was actually an artist, I said, well, how do you keep it so sharp and clean? Because those meanders have to be sharp, and the dishes and the green areas in between, those have to be nice and tight in order for you to appreciate the character of the design. And what they do is every 6 months or as needed, they rent a herd of sheep and cart them all off to the water retention area and let them walk around for 2 days, and they nibble everything short and then they leave again. And I said, well, that's that's really smart, but it sounds like a lot of work. Why don't you just let the sheep live there? And they said, no, we can't have that, because sheep are very much animals of habit, it turns out, and they make their own paths and their own snuggly places where they like to sleep. And then, of course, you would get the sheep design over the man-made design, over the water design, and we can't have that. I mean, we have this beautiful artifact, and let's keep it. So the sheep come and go. Another option for dealing with more water and more surface water, as we've seen, could be perhaps floating housing. This is a neighborhood here in Eiburg in Amsterdam. This is an idea for a floating swimming pool made of shipping containers in the harbor of Rotterdam, which I think is just a lovely idea. This is an idea also for the harbor of Rotterdam for floating parks. why not make also public space floating and then make all these separate islands that you can hook together like a Lego game? The Dutch are also looking at experience elsewhere, and one of the places where they have a lot of experience with dikes is in Japan. And these have to be special dikes because of the seismic danger. An earthquake, of course, can tear a dike apart in no time. And the idea is that we might want to take the Japanese idea of what are called super dikes, which means that the dikes are not so much tall, but very broad. And that means that that can be up to 2 kilometers wide. We would hardly even recognize that as a dike here, I think. And the idea is that these dikes are so big that A, they can't breach, and B, you can use them to build roads or housing or all sorts of urbanization, really accommodate, make the dike part of your cityscape. And here, two designers from Rotterdam, hoping that the Netherlands would still host the Olympics in 2028, sorry to say, but I think the idea is still good, that they would build a super dike along the Maas in Rotterdam, and that this could be the location of the aquatic venue for the Olympic Games of 2028. Speaking of the integration of water measures into public space, one of the most beautiful places where this has been accomplished recently is the new boulevard at the beach of Scheveningen. And you would never really know what you're looking at until you see the picture I'm going to show you now. This is what the boulevard looks like now. And this is what it looks like on the inside. You can't see it. It's only if you know that you know that... Where's it? This is a huge sea dike, which has been incorporated under the boulevard, made up in layers. There's a whole recipe for building a dike, which you don't need to know the details of, and neither do I, as long as the engineers do. And then, as you can see here, the boulevard and the design of the public space above has really been draped over the dike. And I asked them, well, how do you know? Because the people who keep an eye on the safety of the dikes, they want to see the dikes. They want to be able to see if there's a hole or a break. But of course, that can't be done if the dike is hiding out underneath the boulevard. So now they have electronic sensors inside the dike, which send messages to servers saying, oh, it's too dry in here, it's too wet in here, the electric tension between the sand grains is changing. So we're relying increasingly on electronics to tell us about the health of our dikes. And at the same time, using that information, the fact that we don't have to actually see the dike, to create a beautiful new public space along the beach. And an interesting element of that is this. These are really new fake dunes. I mean, they are dunes, but they wouldn't necessarily have to be there because dunes normally are used to keep out the sea. Here they're used for the metaphor of keeping out the sea. And the grass is real, the sand is real, but the whole functional idea of the dunes is no longer really necessary. And this combination of, again, the utilitarian and the aesthetics of water control in the Netherlands, I think, is just a fascinating story. A lot of the new dealings with water are about working with nature, building with nature. This is another innovative idea that's drawn a lot of attention in the rest of the world, called the sand engine, just off the coast near The Hague. And what it really is, basically, is a huge pile of sand. 21 million cubic meters was dredged up out of the North Sea and deposited by these boats that do these beautiful sandy plumes, deposited here just off the coast of the town of Munster. And the idea is that instead of bringing out the bulldozers every year to nourish the beaches and disrupting the whole system and then letting it all wash away again and then getting the bulldozers out again, that if you put down enough sand for the next, say, 20 years, and then let nature do the work, A, it's cheaper, and B, you have a better chance that the sand is deposited in the places where it is really needed. And this is, in 20 years' time, this huge pile of sand will have, as it were, melted away into a little bump off the coast. And right now, it's very popular. It's really interesting to see how quickly a new piece of nature like this changes, and how quickly plants start to grow and ridges come in the sand, and how the shape is changing. So a lot of people have really become very fond of the sand engine just to see how dynamic the landscape really is. And it's just a big pile of sand. Another way we could deal with water in a more friendly way and a cheap and easy way, this is a student's design from the student competition called Archipri. I think it's brilliant. This is also the waterway leading to Rotterdam. And he says, we're so used to seeing water like this as a shipping canal, as a place with no intrinsic value of its own. But people love being near the water, even if it just is a big shipping canal. So why don't we take what we already have, namely these hard lines of stony defense along the water, and we have residential areas over here with hard asphalt streets, and that piece in between. It's a gift. Why don't we just put down some simple paths where people can jog and walk the dog, maybe meet each other, get some fresh air, get some exercise. It can all be very simply furnished, as you can see. You can also have bioswales along the side so that if the water overflows, there's a catchment area for it and it doesn't flood the housing. And I really like this design because I think he has figured out that especially in a country where there are so many kilometers of dikes and waterways to be dealt with, that it's really good to have a simple, robust, resilient structure for doing that without too much design involved. So it's a good design because it doesn't have too much design. One of the things we're doing in a large national program called Room for the River, a 2 billion euro national project with about 39 or 40 individual projects in it, is lowering the dikes so that the water can flow in and take the pressure off the rivers so that the cities don't flood. Same as, for example, in a recent near flooding of New Orleans, along the Mississippi, some spillways were opened. So the Netherlands basically is starting to open spillways. Can you imagine saying to a Dutchman 50 years ago, after the flood of 1953, for example, saying, we're going to lower the dikes because that will be safer? This is such a paradigm shift. It's really hard to imagine that. I really wish I were able to find out who was the first person who thought of this and be a fly on the wall when he told this idea to his boss, that maybe we should do the opposite of what we'd always been doing, and that this would actually be safer and create new landscape. This farmer is not having it. He farms in one of the polders that is going to be depolderized, where the dikes are going to be lowered so that the water can come in when the river is too high, a polder called the Noordwaard, near the Biesbos, for those of you who know the area. And this farmer and his wife, they've been farming there for three generations. They both grew up there, and he said, you know, they're offering us cows with golden horns if we'll leave. We're not leaving. We don't believe in that water. And this is the same man who was hanging by his fingernails from the roof during the flood of 1953 and who lost family and lost cattle. But this idea is just impossible for him to accept. His farm is right about here. So ultimately, he didn't have to leave. But the people in the path of the water that will flow through this polder when the river water is too high, they did have to leave. And I thought this touches on an interesting issue and a social difference also with the U.S. I think in the U.S. it would have been possible for government to say to the people living in the path of the water, you're not safe here. If you decide to stay, it's your own responsibility. That doesn't happen in the Netherlands. You're not safe here, so you have to go, because we are here to guarantee your safety, and we cannot let you stay here in a situation where we know that there is some risk. So this whole idea of the acceptance of risk and what we expect of government and what government expects of us is a very, very interesting process and says a lot about the differences between these two cultures. So talking in this area has been going on, negotiating for about 10 years now. They're trying to buy people out and also to help them find new farms or new houses. And I just heard this week that they've reached agreement with just about everybody. There's one family, apparently, who refuses to go, and they're going to, government is finally going to exercise its right of eminent domain, meaning that they can force people to leave, and still give them compensation, of course, but forcibly buy their farm. And eminent domain is a hugely controversial element, tool in the US, because it's too often used just to give developers their way. So I think it says a lot about the Dutch consensus model, the Polder model, that even for something of national importance like water safety, we're still going to talk this, gum this over until the cows come home, rather than really kicking people out. This is also a polder that's going to be put underwater, but it's a very different story. This is a polder in Brabant called the Overdiepse Polder, near the town of Geertruidenberg. And these farmers, they went about this very differently. It's a group of 17 farms in this polder. And they heard that they were going to be put underwater, or that the water could come, say, every 25 years when the river water is too high. And they said, well, we can fight this, but we can also be smart and be proactive and try to make our own plan and take our fate into our own hands and not just sit back and wait for government to give us compensation and try and figure out what will happen after that. So what did they do? This is the dairy farmer, Noel Hoijmeijers. I was at his farm this last Saturday with the architecture critic Michael Kimmelman of the New York Times, who came to the Netherlands to see how the Dutch are designing for water. And Hoijmeijers was the spokesman of all the farmers in the area. And he said, well, why don't we redesign the farming area and concentrate the farms on huge mounds along the south edge of the polder, so that when the water flows in, it can reach up to 3 meters high, but we will still be able to continue farming on our mounds. And these mounds are 7 meters high, all told. They're 2.5 hectares big, which is quite big, with the idea that once you've built this mound, you can't extend it in the future. You'll just have to stick with what you've got. And I thought this was a really interesting social model that, for the first time, I heard that people didn't feel like victims of this process. They felt that, yes, they didn't want to change, it wasn't their idea, but if change was going to happen, let's take control of that process ourselves. One last example of depolderization. This is the river De Waal near Nijmegen. And here, too, also because of this tight curve in the river, they often have trouble with flooding there. And the idea here is to make a bypass, this bypass along the back, so that you widen the river and give it more space, but you also create new attractive living areas, for example, this handsome residential area here. And this was this fellow I spoke to who built his new house on this area, on this island. He knew that this was going to become attractive with views over the water on both sides, but he also knew that this area, at least then, was still prone to flooding. So what did he do? He built his house basically with the basement above ground. He had a 3 meter tall concrete wall around the bottom of his house, and since they live elevated up on the second and third floors anyway, it doesn't bother him. And he said, well, I hope that when the house is finished, it'll be high and dry. So when the house was finished, I called him, and he said, well, I know what it is now, not only to live on the Maas, but also in the Maas. Very shortly after he'd finished, the water came up again, and he was very glad of his foresight. And I thought it was an interesting example of how architecture also is adapting to all these new challenges and opportunities that the new water situation is giving them. Moving towards the end here, this is the last one of the solutions that I wanted to show you. One of the things that happens through climate change is that the mass of the sea becomes so heavy that it pushes in under the dunes and makes the land salty, makes the, in this case, agricultural land. This is on the island of Texel, and of course they have sea all around, and they have real trouble, as they do in Zeeland, with the agricultural land becoming too salty for the normal crops that they grow. So what has TESOL done together with the Free University here in Amsterdam? They have designed, cultivated Miss Mignon. And Miss Mignon is a salty potato, or at least a potato that can grow in salty conditions, both in salty land, being irrigated with salty water, and growing in salty air, because it's right behind the dunes on the edge of the island of TESOL. And the Dutch really think that this is a contribution to solving world hunger. It's estimated there's over a billion hectares of agricultural land all over the world, which are now too saline for normal crops. So if you have a potato, which is a cheap and durable crop that can grow under in many, many conditions, that can take that salinity, then you really have made a contribution. And this is an important day in the life of Miss Mignon, because this fellow is the potato trader. And this is the day that he has come to TESOL and done the official tasting of the new saline potato. And is the Miss Mignon going to be allowed into the Valhalla of potato dealing? Yes, it is. And it should be available as of the summer of this coming year. Interesting to note is that even though the potato grows under salty conditions, it isn't itself salty. I expected it to be. We had lunch and ate the potato. And I was, to tell you the truth, I was a little disappointed. I thought, hey, I'm onto something really new here. But then they told us that actually the good thing, because you want to control how much salt you eat yourself and not have it already in your food, the leaves of the potato catch the salt as it grows. So the leaves are much saltier than usual, but the potato itself is not. Jochem already mentioned it, and I'm sure we'll talk about it some more. Why do the Dutch not have evacuation plans? One of the things the Dutch thought that they did really well in New Orleans was evacuate. The Dutch themselves, we don't have evacuation plans. We have such faith in the system. We are so sure that the engineers and the water boards and government have taken care of this and have solved the problem for us that we just don't really need them. Strikingly enough, evacuation places, high water places for animals in nature, but we don't have places for people to flee to at high water. That is really hard to explain in the US. Nor do we have flood insurance. That is also very difficult to explain until you say that if there were to be a flood here, the damage would be so huge that no single insurance company could possibly cover that. This is all a government affair. And I wanted to show you this image because after the flood that I showed you in the beginning in the mid-90s, the Dutch started thinking, well, maybe we should work on this evacuation thing. And so we had an evacuation exercise, a national trial, called Waterproof. Of course, there were fake victims and trauma helicopters flying around. And one of the things they did was evacuate animals, because, of course, in a real evacuation, it's very difficult to evacuate animals. They don't understand. They don't want to leave the warm barn and get on a dirty, wet, slippery boat, and they kick and they bite and they run away. So the Dutch thought, well, we should also practice evacuating the animals. But of course it's difficult, it's expensive, maybe an animal will get hurt. It's just a little too complicated. So what did we do? We had this barge, and these guys, I think, are having the day of their life. They're out on this exercise. And what are they carrying around? Plastic animals. And the fact that we do this major national evacuation trial, but then make an easy job out of it, evacuating plastic animals, I think says so much about the faith that we have in our system. And conditions are changing, and I think we should start thinking about whether that faith is still justified and whether we start being more aware of where we live and how it's possible that we live where we do. And my last image is not Dutch, but, of course, American. This is the American way. You solve it yourself. You don't sit around and wait for government to come and get you. You get your bulldozer, you borrow your neighbor's bulldozer, and you build your own dike. And I think this was the image I wanted to leave you with, because this really touches on the issues of who is responsible, who is going to take care of me, to what extent is that a collective issue and therefore also a collective expense, or something that when push comes to shove that each individual will have to do for himself. I think this is a farmer in the Mississippi, in the town of Vicksburg, and I think this really expresses the fierce spirit of independence, also from government and from others, that you might say is more the American spirit, and also the spirit of fixing it after the fact. Well, a little bit, almost after the fact, rather than avoiding the flooding in the first place, the prevention, which I think is more the Dutch mentality. And in Dutch, I like to call this picture Eigen Dijk Eerst. So I'd like to leave you with that, and thank you very much for being here, and I hope there are a lot of questions, and I really enjoyed working on the project and telling you about it this evening. Thank you.
So not only Dutch banks are too big to fail, but also the dikes are too big to fail,
well,
apparently.
Well, let's hope so.
I would very much like you to join in the discussion. I prepared some questions myself around certain topics. And the first topic is, well, how specifically Dutch is your story? Because if you want to, and that is the ambition, show the Dutch example to the world, and maybe as an enlightening example, you first have to know very well how specific it is for the Netherlands before you can start thinking about transferring ideas abroad. But let me start then with this question. Coming from the US, what was your first experience in the Netherlands with this Dutch culture and Dutch culture in respect to water in particular?
One of the first things that struck me as a visitor, I didn't live here, I just came as a visitor in the beginning, was these spongy green cushions that were everywhere. And these ditches that had clearly been made on the drawing table with a ruler and a compass, and how extremely regimented it all was, and how close to the surface the water was. I was born in the desert in California, in the Mojave Desert, in a landscape where there is no visible water. And the fact that the water was everywhere here, and so close to the surface, I found it fascinating. Then I, of course, had no idea how large a role water had played in determining the landscape and the way people lived here and the fact that they could live here at all. But the fact that it was so close to you all the time really struck me.
And did it constitute danger or beauty?
Beauty.
Okay.
Beauty. I think that, remember the picture I showed of all the ditches with the sun shining in the water? And I'd never seen anything like that, so clearly man-made, but still based on that element of nature. And what struck me later was when I started writing about nature in Holland and what is nature here. I was one of those people who thought that pastures were green, so therefore they were nature. But of course, the nature movement soon convinced me that that could not possibly be the case.
Yeah. So let's try to dig a little bit in the specific Dutch cultural traits that explain this success of water management, because, well, you do portray it in your book largely as a success, as ingenuity, as a successful effort. So, yeah, you already mentioned a couple of things, but can you dig in a little deeper in the cultural traits that you think are, well, the conditions that make this type of water management possible.
Well, what I find interesting about what's changing now, and the book emphatically doesn't deal with the whole history of water management. There have been libraries full written on that. I don't need to rehash that. It looks at the future and the innovations and the new ways of dealing with water that we're thinking of now. And what really strikes me is what you also mentioned in your introduction, Jochen, that it used to be so segregated. This was the domain of the engineers, and this was the domain of the planners. Often it was a country and city, and these were very clearly delineated expertises, and these people never really had anything to do with each other and probably basically mistrusted each other. And now you see, because water safety and urbanization are becoming so interlocked, there's starting to be a conversation. I say in the book somewhere, I think that not that they don't speak each other's language yet, they're learning each other's language. And it's still often very difficult because there isn't really much of a premium yet on integrating these disciplines. We all think, yes, it should be done, but there's no real impetus to doing it, and there's no premium for doing it.
Okay. And who should provide the premium? How can we think of creating conditions that this is more stimulated, motivated to do? Why is this premium lacking? Do you have an idea about that?
Well, this is all fairly recent that we've started thinking in a different way about water, thinking about letting water in rather than just building the dikes higher and higher and pumping harder and harder. We've pumped a lot through the centuries, and the land is subsiding, the sea is rising, the rivers are fuller. I think the realization is dawning on a lot of people that we just can't go on doing this the way we always have, that something has to change. But how do you organize that change, and how do you get people to work together to integrate the disciplines? Mm-hmm. I think a really good start would be to integrate, for example, the water board and the public planning institutions. Mm-hmm. They're still completely separate.
Absolutely, yeah.
And they have regular meetings, and they talk a lot, and they think of a lot of wonderful plans. As you saw, a lot of the plans that I talk about in the book are still great ideas and have not been executed yet. Yeah. And we all know that that we're very good at design and at talking, but that implementation here really takes a long time. Mm-hmm. But that's not just here, I have to say.
You mentioned it already also in your own presentation, that we Dutch still put a lot of trust in government. Okay, of course, we complain about government as well. But
sure.
At the same time,
everybody does.
We have expectations. Yeah. Of our government. Isn't that one of the, and of course, yeah, in a historical perspective, we can even say that government earned distrust because the water management has been pretty good. So what came first is an issue for debate. And certainly in comparison with the US, you would immediately say it is trust in government that is a crucial difference. But isn't this at the same time a threat for the Netherlands, because maybe our attitude to government is changing as well?
Yes, our attitude to government is changing. We don't accept things immediately as a given, the way perhaps even the generation of our parents did. And also the role of government is changing. Government is withdrawing and feels less responsible for organizing everything for us, and talks about, but that, I think especially in dealing with water, there's this conflicting dialogue going on, and nobody really has the answer yet. We as citizens are still in the mode of government is taking care of this. Government, on the other hand, is trying to make us aware that maybe government cannot ensure our safety 100% of the time, that shit does happen. But we don't want to hear that. And there's this conflicting dialogue going on of government trying to say, well, maybe you should take your own responsibility and you know, have one of these emergency packages which just makes everybody laugh in the attic. And they haven't succeeded in explaining to us what our own responsibility in this is. How can you, I mean, unless you're this farmer in Vicksburg with a bulldozer and can make your own dike, how can you be responsible for your own water situation? It's simply not possible. And I think government, and especially elected officials, are reluctant to tell their voters things that are not popular. And then the population will turn around and say, but you told us the dikes were safe. I mean, what's going on here? You're letting us down. So this is, we're in the middle of a very difficult, in design, it's an exciting paradigm shift. In the governance atmosphere, it's a very difficult time trying to get democratically elected officials to say things that people don't want to hear and to give people some sense of what they really can do themselves. Because awareness of water issues here among the general population is minimal. Most people don't even know how high their house is or if there was a flood.
It's paradoxical.
What would happen to their stuff? It's really paradoxical. We don't trust government, but we don't want to take responsibility for the alternative either.
And it's a dilemma for the government as well, because the whole system is based on trust in the system, and in institutions. And if you start talking about system failure and the fact that disaster can strike and that you have some responsibility yourself, then you're undermining the system immediately.
Even talking about the possibility of failure is undermining the system. There's one wonderful word in Dutch. I'm sure many of you will. How many Dutch speakers do we have, actually? Oh, fine. Okay, well. There's one word that I think really says it all. It's a new kind of invention about a dike that's called a overslagbestendige dijk.
Yeah.
Okay?
I know why you're not translating it.
Yeah. Overslag in English is overtopping, which means that water can come over the top of the dike. But bestendig means that it's prepared to... It can take it.
Accommodated, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And so government hears bestendig. Yeah. And the citizens here, overslaw. And they say, wait a minute, there's not supposed to be water coming over the dike. And government says, no, it's okay because the dike can take it. And I think this combination of these two concepts in one word just says it all.
Right, yeah. And you, of course, in your the things you have done the last couple of years, amongst which writing this book, you have talked to many professionals in the water sector. And my experience is that certainly people at water boards are very reluctant at talking about system failure, about personal responsibility. How is your experience in that?
Yes, very reluctant, very reluctant. And another thing they're reluctant to talk about is money. And that's why in the book I mention one of the dijkgraven, the head of the water board in Rijnland, near Leiden. Mm-hmm. He was the first person who dared to say, to what extent, I mean, we regard water safety as a collective issue here and a collective responsibility, and I think that's one of the wonderful things about the Dutch system. But at the same time, as the water becomes saltier, we have to clean it more. For example, for the tree growers in the area around Boskoop, trees cannot take any salt at all, unlike the Miss Mignon. So when the water gets too dirty, they have to cut it off. They've even actually let the water flow in the opposite direction to keep this salty water from ruining and creating economic havoc in the tree-growing area. And then this man, this dijkgraaf, said, well, to what extent is this really a collective thing? Isn't this just one economic sector for which we, as taxpayers, are really having to pay too much? And the fact that someone in his position would even mention this, that perhaps one of these sectors should be responsible for their own sweet water and for cleaning it or bringing it in tanks, whatever that would mean. This was, I don't know if he realized how revolutionary it was that he even dared to bring this up, that that this collectiveness might have a...
That there are different ways of looking at the problem and
the
solutions.
And that it might not always be all paid by all of us.
Right, yes.
Dijkgraaf is
appointed.
Appointed.
It is just like the mayors in the
like
Netherlands.
Mayors,
like they have a council which is elected, and they have sort of aldermen as well. But the chairman, Dijkgraaf, is appointed by the crown, the ministers.
No interest. be elected, the active system? It's one of the oldest institutions that there is, the bath and spa.
Yeah, there are elections for water boards.
No,
nobody's interested to vote. At 26% turnout last time.
Yeah, that's correct. That's another. Maybe we can come back to that a little later on. This functioning of these this particular type of institution. Are there any other questions at this stage? Yeah, maybe here for sorry.
Hurricane Sandy, I saw pictures on the internet with people planning to build a storm surge barrier just outside New York City. And it was apparently a Dutch proposal. Do you know, it cost things on like $10 billion, if I remember rightly. Do you know if that project is actually going to go ahead?
Oh, no, it's much too early to know. No. But I think if anything can create the political will to make this kind of huge investment, it's something like Sandy. But, of course, all the Dutch firms like Arcadis and Royal Hoskoning, they were on the first plane to land at JFK when the hurricane was over to start promoting their business, of
it's
course.
Business, yeah.
Of course, it's business. But no, there have certainly been no decisions made yet in New York, and they've just New York has just put a request in for what was it, 25 or 30 billion in aid just for damage, and then you would have to make at least that same investment again in this huge infrastructure.
Take a question here from the lady over there.
When we think about water rising, two meters. The sea, the North Sea, 2 meters higher with a 2 meter higher surge or even more. What happens to The Hague or Bloemendaal? I mean, you can't protect the whole thing. At some point, we have to accept that some of those cities just can't be there anymore in 50 years. Isn't that so?
The Dutch are not accepting the idea of retreat yet. I don't know if it will happen in our lifetime.
Where do we go?
We go to Germany.
I have a question here below.
Here. I live on the water, but every year in November, I have to clean my dishes. It's very strict. There's very strict control that you clean the waterway so the water can flow where it should flow. So there is a responsibility. But another thing, your last picture could not have been taken in the belt, Christian belt, because in the February disaster 53, all those people in Zealand said it was God's will. They didn't want anything because God wanted to flood their country.
But that was where they opened the floodplain, right? So New Orleans wouldn't get flooded. So it wasn't God, it was person who opened the
So that there's also this element of the Dutch, that they let it go because the Christian Dutch said. And there's another remark, that's Rijkswaterstaat is a state in the state. Mm-hmm. Those people, I think you mentioned that, was interesting. They're so strict, they do what they want. They don't care about anything, about nature. We had a house in Schuylendijk. It was the most beautiful bay, a dune bay. And what they did, the Rijkswaterstaat, they just planned that dike to be exactly there in that bay to then demolish it. They couldn't care less. And they are
safety first, huh? Yeah. For a long time, this was the motto. But I think this mentality is changing.
It's God and Rijkswaterstaat here.
please.
Completely agree. I'm a younger generation than you, but I've grown up in also mentions the Bonnenwaard, which is like an aisle within the rivers, like in the Waal and the Maas. And there we had this dike that had to be lifted up, had to be moved. It was very strict. Our neighbors had to be tear down the house. They did compensate. They built a beautiful new house, but it was not the same. And my parents bought this house in the 80s, knowing that the dike would be moved, but our neighbors had to go. It's something that it's just normal within, like the state, like the comparison of Rijkswaterstaat as a state within the country is true. And very true.
I spoke to a lady in on the that same island where the man with the raised basement had built his house. Just a little way down the road, there was a family who had a lovely old farm. They had to move their farm for 100 meters.
Hmm. Well, that's how powerful government is in the end. Yeah, and in general, it is accepted because very seldom you see violent responses. Although in the you also mentioned the room for the river example, I think it would be wrong to portray it as a complete success story because there have been heavy protests against these kinds of interventions, with dike graven being protected by the diplomatic service because they had death threats, for example. So it's a mixed picture in that sense. But trust goes further than trusting government. I think also your story clearly shows that the Dutch have a very big trust in technology. You gave the example of the Maasland barrier, Maasland Kering. But I also know that one of these tests, it failed.
Mm-hmm.
So it can fail. The system can fail. But the impression is that nobody really seems to realize that system failure is an issue and is becoming bigger since the system is getting more complicated and more stressed.
Yeah, the Maasland barrier is run by a computer.
Yeah.
It senses when the water gets too high and when the thing has to close. And I thought, gee, I hope this computer runs on different software than the computer on Wall Street that starts to sell like crazy when certain stocks drop below a certain level. And then you create this huge wave of panic and leaving our decisions to technology. But it's never, at least in Maasland barrier, it's not only technology. There is human control.
There's backup.
Control as well.
Yeah. But still,
but the question will be, of course, in 50 years, depending on what happens with climate change, what will the next Maasland barrier look like? What will the next Oosterschelde barrier look like? Will they be even bigger, or will we let more water in? Will we be less defensive? I'm really curious what the next generation of infrastructure is going to be like as the climate changes and as our insights change.
Right.
I don't understand.
Can I have just one follow-up question on this? Is this trust in technology, is it, and specifically in this area, is it typical Dutch or is that also encountered in the U.S.?
You could also say, Jochem, that part of the reason for this whole change towards more natural methods, wetlands, lowering the dikes, that means that we are increasingly moving our trust from technology to natural measures. Don't you think?
Yes, but it's still based on
human intervention.
That we can manage the danger.
Yes.
Room for the river is still based on the idea that we can manage the danger.
Yes.
And
lowering the dikes is also based on the idea that we can manage the danger. This whole country is premised on the assumption that we can manage the danger.
Yeah.
And if we really do no longer believe that, we will move to Germany.
Yeah, and no, well, and it, before it was our trust in God, but now...
Well... God and Rijkswaterstaat, as you
said.
Here in the middle. Yeah, you.
Okay. When you say trust in nature, what I was missing, and I don't know how far that is relevant for Holland, but usually when you have a forest environment, the forest acts as a sponge.
Yes.
So when you have these downpours of water, then for example, you can actually release the impact on the canalization, this and the other. I was also very glad to see my neighborhood, they're putting in a new street. Instead of just having concrete, they put the bricks in again, which again has the same effect. Now again, it could be that it's 1, 2%, 5%, 10%. Have you got any idea what these natural systems can do? Because when you have just a basin or even the meandering, it is just still quantity. You actually capture the masses of water, which have an immediate impact, rather than have a more slowing down of the overall impact.
Well, some of the examples I showed, the water retention areas are water calming measures meant to slow it down. Just hang on to it for a while and let it slowly dissipate. But there is an example that I'm sure will interest you in one of these depoldering areas, also the Noordwaard, near where the farmer I showed you who didn't believe in water. There's a new kind of dike being built there called a delta dike, which has a very, very, very long sloping outer slope. And around that outer slope, they're planting a willow forest. And it's for the first time in this country that a willow forest is officially recognized by Rijkswaterstaat as part of a primary dike, because the whole idea of the willow forest is that it will indeed calm the water if a storm comes pounding towards the dike, and the combination of this swath of willow forest and this very long slope will hopefully take the power out of the waves. So that's a new kind of introduction of nature to calm the water and hold on to it.
So that's more to soften the impact. I was more thinking, as I said, a forest acts like a sponge. For example, it rains, and then you get this slow release following the rain.
Oh, yeah. Oh, there are a lot of initiatives, for example, building new wetlands.
Yeah, you should, if I may add, do these things on the level of an estuary or a whole river system. So if you look at the Rhine, yes, this is a strategy you should apply upstream in the Rhine to keep the water over there. So there you're talking about a characteristic of the Netherlands being a small country in a much larger water system.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Dutch have tried to buy land in Germany, haven't they, upstream?
That's very complicated.
As a water catchment area? Yeah. Has that happened?
I don't know. I only know that the law has been changed 10 years ago to make it possible to allow the Dutch government to use taxpayers' money to invest abroad, because that wasn't possible. The law simply said, well, taxpayers' money invested in infrastructure has to be done within the country.
Okay. Well, the woningcorporaties have been doing it for quite a while now.
Yeah, so. But they are. Yeah, and they are sent to court as well. The lady here.
I was just wondering, for all these computer sensors and everything like that to control the gates or the check the conditions of the dike and everything, where are they in the power grid, or where does the power come from? Because I assume when you have a big storm coming in, you don't want to just assume the power grid will always be okay, right? So.
Yeah.
In a storm, yeah.
I assume they have a generator. But I don't know.
Very good question to which I have no answer. I don't know. I'll find out.
We have a question over
here. Sorry, yeah.
The first polders were made, or the water was pumped out by wind, our mills, the mill system. So why now they are hiring up dikes instead of making more mills to pump the water out? What's the use of hiring up dikes instead of having pumps? Probably with wind energy, I don't know.
But we still do have pumps. And the fact that we have to raise the dikes.
Money, there's more invested in dikes than in pumps.
Well, this is such a detailed technical question.
Yeah.
I think
yeah.
we have to pass on this one.
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to that. Here, the gentleman over here.
Tracy, I'd like to come back to this gentleman's question about New York and Hurricane Sandy. I heard also discussion, I think it was on American TV, maybe CNN, and somebody said, why can't we just use one of those Dutch solutions and close off the Verrazano, outside the Verrazano Bridge? Oh no, that's no good, because then you still have the East River coming in your back door. But the East River is tidal, and that can be closed off much more simply than the Verrazano Straits.
I've heard talks of barriers in both, but that still leaves unaddressed the fact that all of New Jersey, for example, will still be vulnerable, which was where so much of the damage was now.
Yeah, and you also said the cost is a major problem.
Oh, huge, yeah. And when I went to the Maaslandt barrier with Michael Kimmelman last Saturday, it's very beautiful, but it's also really rather small, relatively speaking. And if you place this on a map over the Verrazano Narrows, which are not narrow at all, and it's the magnitude of this of the barriers you would need is just tremendous. And I spoke to a Dutch expert about this, someone who works at the VU, and he said, well, you know, what we've discovered 50 years after building some of this infrastructure is the ecological damage that it's caused.
Yeah.
And is this really what you want to do, or should you do a whole series of smaller local measures? And what you should also do, he said, is keep to the building codes that New York already has. Don't put your all your electricity in the basement, and make sure that when you build new buildings, they're above a certain level. So there are all sorts of regulations already in place that if they were enforced, there would be less trouble. But you weren't finished with your question, Tim.
Have you spoken with any Dutch specialist who said, yes, we could do it?
Well, yes, it can be done. Yeah.
Okay.
The company Arcadis built a huge barrier outside of New Orleans, which struck me as very old school. Yes, it can be done, but the question is, what will the consequences be in the long run? Is there the political will to spend that amount of money? And what will you do with the other parts of the same region which are still left unprotected?
In the Netherlands, and this was actually raised before, it is automatically, you think that the danger in, with respect to climate change comes from the sea level rise, for example. But that's not actually true. In general, it's considered that with the present state of the dunes and the barriers, we're pretty safe this century from the sea. The danger is in our back. It's coming from the rivers, which will have very different discharge figures. And, the dikes are in less good shape anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the river water comes quickly.
Yeah.
Vroom, and then it floods. And within maybe 2-3 days.
Right.
And sea level rise along the coast, of course, is a much more gradual, not that it's slow, but it's a gradual process.
And you can anticipate.
Yeah.
The gentleman in the...
Michiel.
Can the mic go there? Is that...
I want to pick up on the cultural wave, if you want, and the culture mentality, which is behind all this fascinating history. And I know Tracy's very good at sensing cultural waves, not just the water waves we heard about today. But the last 60 years, the way I see it, all these solutions and all this approach from a cultural mentality is an engineering mentality. And the engineering mentality, just to paraphrase, is large, high-tech solutions, and it's top-down and big national government that goes with it. The way I see things changing in design, and Tracy has also written about that, there's this whole wave of participatory design, open design, in a way local design, if you want neighborhood design. How do you see that play out, that if it's so much about trust in technology or government, and it's maybe moving to a trust in what you can do yourself or locally, that there will be a real conflict? I mean, can we have neighborhood solutions to these issues if that is what socially, culturally people want much more, I think?
Yeah.
Please, yeah.
Well, you'll have to bring neighborhoods in for solutions like the water squares that I showed you in Rotterdam. If you don't, what will happen is what already happened there, namely that the city had decided that they wanted to build one of these water squares in a certain neighborhood where a lot of immigrants lived. And the immigrants were up in arms because they said, "We don't want that here. Our children can't swim." And I was shocked when I heard that, because I just assumed that everybody's first and second diploma was a swimming diploma, which apparently it no longer is. Or perhaps this fear was unfounded, I don't know, but there was great neighborhood resentment, and they had to withdraw the plan and are now building the first water square in a whole different neighborhood where there are much fewer people living, where there are schools and a church and fewer children around who could possibly fall in. So you will have to... Yeah, well, this is a new kind of solution on a much smaller scale. And how many of these water squares will you need for it really to make a difference? I mean, That's another thing that nobody's talking about in this charming design. Is there any economy of scale possible in something like this? But you will have to work on a neighborhood scale and bring people in to participate in the planning procedure for something like this, because if you don't, they will block the process, and people are, of course, getting much more agile at going to the courts to block government decisions. The only really participatory example that I have seen was the one I talked about in the Overdiepse Polder, where the farmers decided to design these mounds and then decided among themselves who would get a mound. And that was a very painful social process. There were people who had been neighbors for decades who were no longer talking to each other because there was a scarcity of mounds. So it's nowhere near the scale of, for example, the discussion on open design in the design world. It's still a much more top-down driven process. But gradually that will change as I think the awareness of this problem and the fact that something has to give will grow. Okay. I hope my book contributes to that.
Okay, the Netherlands, from what you have told us and what you can read in the book, it is a difficult transformation process from a model that we had basically for ages to something new. But I also start to conclude that the conditions in this country are such that there are limitations to innovations. We are a very small country, densely populated. We cannot move to Germany. We are a rich country in the end. We can afford this way of managing our water. Isn't it like Pilkey and Young, the book you know as well, I know, conclude in their book on sea level rise and climate change, they have a very nice description of very different parts of the world. And they refer to the Netherlands as well, but always in the sense that the Netherlands is the odd one out. It's interesting case, it's fascinating, but well, it's so different. What is your conclusion?
It is very different because we have a centuries-long jump on everyone else. We've had to deal with water for so long that it's really a given here. And for example, New York is all of a sudden having to deal with water, and that's not a given at all, and it's a shock. What can happen and the expense involved and the damage involved. So yes, we're the odd one out because we've been doing this for ages, for centuries. But we're not necessarily the odd one out in the sense of innovative thinking, because we have a lot of really excellent, top-notch landscape designers. We have a lot of really excellent and gifted engineers. And if we can combine that talent, I think we can really, really produce things that will benefit not just the Netherlands, but also the rest of the world. And that doesn't necessarily have to be high-tech solutions. I think that the paradigm shift here is the backpedaling that we can try to keep that man-made situation in place, but with more natural measures, which, of course, is a typical Dutch paradox.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right, thanks. I will allow for one or two questions, and then we have to draw it to an end. In the back.
I was sorry. I was suddenly wondering, had you been speaking with the Prince of Orange, and what is his role in this whole realm?
He accepted the first copy of the book, and he opened the exhibition. But we didn't have much of an exchange. I did speak to a lot of people who said that he was indeed very interested, and I think his most important role is that of ambassador. And I told him also at the opening of the exhibition, I spoke to him directly and said that it was really thanks to him that I became aware that this was an issue at all. I remember when he decided that his
royal mission would be water management, and I remember distinctly thinking, water? That's it. Is that iets? That's been taken care of, hasn't it? Mm. And so I've gone through a long learning process myself, inspired by his choice, realizing that, oh, well, yes, there is a story here. There is a growing issue here. And I think his choice, combined with my time in the Delta Commission and my work at the Graduate School of Design at Harvard, where all the students are fascinated by Holland and what's being thought up here, really opened my eyes to a new aspect of this country that I had never even seen before.
We have a last question in the back.
As Venice has a lot of canals, and lately has been flooded, are the Dutch doing anything in Venice to prevent this from happening again?
Venice is working on a system of submerged barriers in the lagoon outside the city. I don't really know, do you, Jochem, if Dutch engineers or advisors are involved? I'd be surprised if they weren't, because they're everywhere.
Arcades must be there. Yeah. Arcades, I don't know, but they must be there. Yeah.
But when you go to the Maaslon barrier, if you've never been, it's really quite wonderful to see. And they have a very interesting, informative visitor center where they show lots of solutions from other cities and countries. By the way, in the book, in each of my chapters in the book, I've included an example from elsewhere, also to show that Holland is not alone in this. That's the Mekong Delta, Hamburg, the east coast of China, New York, and New Orleans.
Okay. Well, back to the book. That's what it all started with as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. It really is. It really is. This is just... Here you go. Thank you very much.